Hello everybody and welcome back to another Substance Designer tutorial. Now I know it's been a little while since I did a big tutorial and I do apologize for that. The holidays were a little bit crazier than I was expecting, but here we are back for the new year. Hope you guys had a good break. And as you can see, we're putting together this time around a sort of a generic wood surface here with knots in the surface, wood grain that goes around the knots, different controls here. We're going to be learning things like how to be able to control the number of concentric circles within the knots on the wood here, how to do things like be able to mask and change the number of knots on the surface of the wood, play around with the random seed. You can see different versions of the same wood material showing up. So it's 100% procedural inside Substance Designer. Quite a nice generic wood effect, if I do say so myself. So let's go ahead and dive straight into the tutorial right off the bat. Now I'm going to be creating a new graph with my PBR output template. If you guys have any questions about how I have a custom graph or why I have my custom graph set up by default as it is, that was some of the most asked questions I had in my previous tutorials. And a couple weeks ago, I in fact put together a tutorial specifically for creating your own custom graphs and in fact creating this custom graph in particular. So if you guys want to learn about that, I will have it linked with a card on the screen here in the description, etc. Just check it out. You can find out my channel. So I'm going to call this maybe generic wood tutorial and make sure that I save my package in case of any crashes or whatever. You always do that in anything you're working on, whether it's a Word document or a Blender file or a Unity, or you always save religiously. That's definitely something you want to get in the habit of doing because it will save your butt. So yeah, we have an absolutely blank graph here. Let's go ahead and start working. The first thing we're going to do is start creating the basis of our wood grain on our surface. And I'm going to start off with these anisotropic noise lines here. And we're going to do a few layers of warping on this to create a little bit more of a wood grain sort of pattern. So I'm going to grab that with some couple levels of purlin noise. Line these all up nicely. Tap space, add a warp. So up top here, I'm going to have a very warped, very low level warped sort of wood grain effect, maybe 0.3. And if you don't have, sorry, I forgot to mention this, on my second monitor, I do in fact have a few different pictures I grabbed from Pixabay. You can go to Pixabay or Google Images, whatever, grab some reference photos. I always recommend having reference photos to work with. The big things to take away from these reference photos I'm using is that the knots in the surface usually have some cracks and splits in the wood going through them, and the wood grain tends to sort of warp around the knots on the surface, sort of goes around them. So those are kind of the two main effects that we're going to be going for here as we get further into this tutorial. So the first things first, we have sort of a wavy wood-looking organic surface here. Maybe 0.25 is pretty good. So those are sort of low-level, high-intensity noise there, low-level lines. Keeping in mind that the way to create anything that's realistic-looking or organic is, of course, layering levels and levels of effects on top of each other. So now I'm going to add big noise, so we have little noise, big noise, and these lines feed into both of them. I'm a little bit OCD about the way I organize my graphs, so I kind of try to make things slightly symmetrical, slightly nice looking if I can. A little bit of a quirk about the way I work, but you know, I digress. So just adding a few layers of warping there so we get these sort of wavy, organic-looking wood lines. Grab that by accident. I just want to pull these over. Okay, so we have the basis of those lines, but on their own, these are fairly flat. The next thing we want to do is grab some directional noise. Where is that? Dirt, directional noise. And you can see this has much more of a fine wood grain sort of look with little bits of almost like debris in the wood, little bits of fibers and things like that, which I think looks really nice as a wood grain. So we're going to blend this with the wood grain that we already have. maybe set it to something like screen. Blend this in there, just have a little faint bit of the wavy wood going through it to give it some shape. And let's go ahead and do a little bit of subtle warping on the grain too. Now the grain, for the most part, does follow fairly linearly, very straight and horizontal, but just a little bit of a warping there, the large level warping should improve the look just a touch. There we go, that looks a little bit more organic, a little bit more realistic. Very nice, very nice. Let's move these over. Let's start plugging this into our normal output so we can start seeing what we are working on in the viewport. There we go, that's looking pretty cool. Now the last thing I'm going to add is I'm going to find our, what number is this? Grunge Map 05, because it has some very large striations that look like sort of a bark on a wood surface, which I think adds a nice touch of organic effect in just one grunge map. So we can have that. I'm going to rotate it by 90 degrees so it's horizontal along with the rest of our wood grain noise here. I'm just going to blend this on top very subtly. In fact, I might just use the multiply mode. So we just get a little bit of darkness and then pull that back to 0.3. Compare before and after. We just get subtle striations in our woods, subtle banding. Very subtle, but I think it adds to the organic look of it all. So we're going to take these, move them down and out of the way just a little bit so we can start working on the next part of our effect. In fact, I'm going to add a frame here and name this Wood Grain Base. Keep everything organized, make sure we know what each part of our graph does. So, we have our wood grain base. The next part of our effect, of course, is adding the knots on the surface of our wood. So to do this, I'm going to use a tile random. And I'm going to set this to paraboloid, so we get sort of soft discs that are sort of stretched and slightly random, and we're going to add a lot more to this randomness. So I'm going to play with the scale random, I'm going to play with the rotation random, position offset a little bit, offset random, just random. We want everything to be random, so you get a lot of everything about making an organic, realistic-looking thing is having that little bit of randomness so it doesn't look computer-generated. It looks realistic, like it's something that just happened in the real world. And now to reduce the number of these, I'm going to use the mask here, but I'm actually going to invert it. Now, the reason I'm inverting it is because we're going to expose this parameter as the amount of our knots on the surface. But if we had it exposed as the amount here, it'd be counterintuitive. So a lower number would have more and a higher number would have less. That's counterintuitive from an artistic sense. So if I just hit invert on the mask here, a higher number will have more of them and a lower number will have less of them. So that just makes more intuitive, straightforward sense in terms of your artistic control. So as we get to the end of the tutorial, you could expose this parameter. So you could, in Unity or Unreal Engine, if you bring this in as a procedural, then you'd have that exposed in your editor for runtime. You could actually just play around with this one setting instead of having to go back to your Substance Designer to change the number of knots on your surface per material. So this is going to be the basis of the knots on our surface, and it sort of scatters these little paraboloids across the surface, which is what we're looking for, except we're going to need two of these. Now the reason we're going to need two of these, two copies, two instances, is one of these is going to be used for warping and masking on the surface of our grain, and the other is actually going to have the height information that we're going to use for our height and our base color, which is going to have the concentric rings, and it's going to have the cracks in the rings, and things along those lines. So we need one that is going to just be the mask and the basis for warping, and one that's going to actually have the height information inside of the warping and masking that we've done. It's going to make another copy of this. Now the good thing is, because these are both using the same seed, the exact same seed, when you copy them, they're going to be exact. So if I double click, both of these look exactly the same, which is perfect. That means we can use two copies and have different inputs to them, and they're going to look exactly the same. So if I were to take something like a shape here, Maybe even use something weird like a pyramid so you can really see what I'm going for before I actually go into the tutorial too far. And use the pattern input, you can see that these are actually aligned in exactly the same places. So whatever we put into here now is going to line up with what we put into here. So these things will, these will align, they'll work together hand in hand, harmoniously, very nicely, exactly what we're looking for. So I'm going to use this as a paraboloid input, and now you can see that these look exactly the same. Now the technique here, very interesting technique that I learned from studying some of the materials you can find out on a substance share, watching other people's tutorials, just constantly learning. If you take this shape, and I'm going to go back to, where is it, my patterns, use a gradient linear here, turn the tiling up, and then I'm going to add a gradient dynamic. Now the way the gradient dynamic is a little bit hard to explain, it sort of maps one onto the other. I think Allegorithmic has a tutorial video and they have documentation on their website for how it works, but the technique here is to plug your little paraboloid here into the top input to your grayscale input and these lines into your bottom input. And now if we set this to vertical orientation, you can see that now we have concentric rings radiating out from the center, and we control the number of rings by changing the gradient linear 2 here, the tiling on it. Now you can see that we have a little bit of an issue. It's popping back and forth, white background, black background, white background, black background. Now the reason that we have this issue is the way the tiling works. You can see that we have these bands here going across, and if I have it set to 7, there's 7 of these, so the tiles actually end with black on the outsides, but if I go to 8, the way that they tile is there's sort of half on the top, half on the bottom, so you have white on the outside. That's the reason that the background is popping between black and white, is because of whether or not you have black on the edges or white on the edges for how the tiling works. Now we can actually fix this. What we're just going to do is add another blend map. I'm going to put this into our foreground input. I'm going to use this into our background into our opacity mask input rather. And now, if I change the tiling, you can see that it's no longer showing in the blend the popping. The popping's still happening on our gradient dynamic. You can see, if I go back over here and watch the gradient dynamic, it's still popping on the gradient dynamic, black and white in the background, but because we're using this shape as an opacity mask, it's actually cutting off the edges and feathering it so we don't actually see the white popping in the background. And I can in fact go in here and add a histogram scan and bring the position up or down, and it will sort of change the contrast, change how much of the dot we're seeing, so we can make this here bigger or smaller, or tighten or soften the edges of it. So now I have a little bit of control here that I could expose later if I wanted to. I'm going to leave it at 0.95 so it gets sort of hard edges, and maybe 0.85 so it gets slightly softer edges. And now we fix the popping in the background, we don't have to worry about using odd or even numbers, and we actually have a control here that we can expose to change the size of these individuals and to change the feathering on them, etc. Really, really cool. So let's pop that into our tile random input here. And now you can see that it's using these concentric ringed little knots and tiling them on our surface, and it does still line up with our other tile random. Perfect. Now I want to add the cracks that you usually see on the surface of knots on a wood surface. So let's go ahead and move this over, give ourselves some room, and I'm going to grab from my noises, what is this, Grunge 11, I believe. Yeah, Grunge 11 has these really nice cracks. I'm going to turn the balance up a little bit to brighten it, sort of get rid of a little bit of the noise in the background. I want to keep some of it, but just not all of it. And now the crack slider here is slightly counterintuitive. If we bring it down, you get more cracks. If you bring it up, you get less cracks. Slightly counterintuitive. That's why we inverted our masking, to try to fix some of the counterintuitive stuff that you get with the way sliders get exposed, etc. So that's looking pretty good, I think. I'm going to pop that over here, add a transform 2D, and have the size so it tiles a couple times, so it's slightly smaller cracks, and I'm going to blend them on top of our knots. Now the reason that I'm blending them after our tile random instead of before our tile random is so that we get well, more random surfaces. If I plugged in the blend node here, each of these concentric circles, each of these knots on our surface would have the exact same pattern of cracks in the surface, which I don't want. I want them to pop through slightly more randomly. So now if I go over here and set this to multiply, you can see that the cracks on this surface don't look the same as the cracks on that surface, don't look the same as the cracks over here, so it makes it a little bit more organic, makes it a little bit more random than if I put it in here and each of these had the exact same input. Perfect, so now we have concentric rings in knots on our surface, and we have the cracks in the knots on our surface, so we can just start to get into blending these on top. So if I add a blend, take our wood grain as the background, take our knots as the foreground, and set this to something like screen. You can see the problem is they're just showing up on top. They're really, very bright. You can still see the grain of the wood underneath. That's not what we want. We want these to actually be slightly isolated, which is why we held on to this copy of the surface for warping and for masking. So now if we plug that into our opacity mask input, you can see that it's starting to mask these off from the background. Now I do want to play with this a little bit to make sure the masking is a little bit more pronounced. So just like we did up here to use the histogram scan, I'm going to do the same thing, histogram scan, bring that up, 0.82, maybe 0.9, using this as our mask, and let's see, that should be masking it off pretty well. Ah, problem is I should probably set it back to copy so we can actually, yeah, so now it's isolated, it's not showing through. There we go. Maybe bring that histogram scan down just a bit, maybe 0.65. Now we still have the issue that these are quite a bit brighter than the noise in the background, so what I'm gonna do is add a levels and just bring the white values down, the intensity of our white values down until they sort of match up with our background a little bit better. Now the reason isn't to have it show through in the background better, but because we want our height information to be fairly flat, these want to be on the same level as the rest of our wood noise. So if we plug this into our normal maps so we can see what's going on, if I didn't bring down the intensity of the white values here, left them very bright, you could see that the height information of our knots is actually a lot more intense than the grain of the wood underneath, and it looks a little bit out of place. So we just bring the intensity of our wood knots down a bit, flatten these off, make them about the same level and intensity as our wood grain. They seem to be a little bit more grounded. They seem to match up with our wood grain a little bit better. They seem more grounded in reality. Now the next problem we're running into here in terms of the look of our knots on the surface is that the wood grain sort of comes in, gets cut off, and then goes out again. It doesn't go around our knots like we would really expect from a wood surface. Because the knots on our surface is where bits like the tree branches would have been chopped off and things like that, and the rings, the grain of the wood would have been going around it. It would have been transitioning into the rest of the wood or the branches and things like that. So the grain sort of morphs itself into that concentric circles as it goes outwards into the next part of the tree. So we want some warping here to simulate, yeah, the grain going around the knots in the wood, that transition in the wood. So we're going to go down. We have our wood, the base grain here. I'm going to add a warp input. Now, if anybody remembers from our concrete mandala tutorial, when I was doing the flowers on the surface, I had two paraboloids that I symmetrized, and then I was using that to push and pull on the surface to warp the surface. Same sort of concept here, because I'm taking these random paraboloids on our surface, and I'm going to use these to sort of push and warp the wood away from the center of the wood knots. So I'm going to use this as our gradient input. Grayscale input is going to be our wood, and oh, what's gone wrong? You might be asking what's gone wrong. Now, as much as these paraboloids look fairly soft, they actually have relatively hard edges. And the problem here is that we need softer edges for the warping to actually sort of push outwards from the center instead of just sort of twisting what's inside them. So what we actually need to do is add just one more blur high quality in here to make them even that much softer. It's going to bring this over, bring the warp over so they'll node doesn't do weird things traveling back on itself. I'm going to turn the quality up just because it's sort of a focal point of our effect, is having these wood knots. And now you can see, there we go, the wood is being sort of pushed and warped around where the knots are going to be placed. So now if we replace this for our background input, there we go. You can see that the knots in the wood now have the grain sort of warping around them. Now the warping is a little bit excessive. You can see it looks a little bit distorted, too much. You can see like the center, these little swirls in the center that we get. It looks like the grain is being warped a little bit too far. That's this very easily solved problem. I'm just going to bring down the intensity of a warp, maybe to like 0.5. There we go. Now the grain is sort of going around the warp, around the knots in our surface, without it looking too strange. That's pretty good, I think. There we go. So now we have the knots in our wood. We have controls that we can expose to randomize it. And if we have the same controls for each, we can randomize them in parallel. This is all doing pretty well. Now I want to make sure that we have everything graphed, labeled and organized. So I want to make sure that this is labeled as the knots in our surface. And I want to make sure that this is all labeled as the wood grain knots warp. Slightly long name, but as long as you know what it means when you go back to look at your graphs later on, it's useful. The biggest problem with having graphs in Substance Designer is you make a graph, you bring it into a project, and then months down the line you go, I don't quite like this, I want to tweak some of the way the surface looks, and then you just see this graph and it's overwhelming, and you don't know what you're looking at, you don't know what each part of the graph does. That's a nightmare. So you always want to make sure that you leave notes and comment on your files, have frames, know what each bit of the file does. Like, comment your code, people. If you're coding, comment your code. Same sort of deal here. Make sure you have frames, make sure you have comments, make sure you know what you're doing. So now we have all of the height information pretty much done. We have the knots, we have the cracks in the knots, we have the warping in our wood surface. Let's start getting into our base color and roughness. So for our base color, I'm going to do the same thing I believe I did with our concrete mandala, where I'm going to use a bitmap to sample colors for our gradient. So we're still doing things 100% procedurally. I'm just going to link this resource in. This bitmap here isn't actually going to be used for output. It's not like I'm taking this and using it as a texture. So this isn't like a bitmap to material. I'm not doing anything along those lines. What I'm using this bitmap for is to steal colors from the real world, sample colors from the real world, and then apply them with a gradient map into our substance. So the colors that we have actually match up with reality just that little bit better. So I'm going to add, not a blur, my mind is in two places at once now. I'm going to add a gradient map, and unfortunately I accidentally grabbed, or I accidentally had this still clicked, so I was trying to plug that in. So I'm going to grab our height information here, and I'm going to expose our base color input on our base material node and plug in this gradient map. And now let's double click over here, gradient editor, pick gradient, and let's find some colors. Now the gradient goes from dark to light, low areas to high areas, so let's see, how does that look? Not enough detail. Let's move, zoom in, gradient editor, pick gradient, let's see, dark to light, how does that look? That looks a lot better, there we go. Might just be a touch too noisy still. Yeah, maybe just a little bit too noisy still. Let's pick a gradient one more time, do a slightly shorter line. No, that's ugly. You know what? I'm just going to control Z a couple times. Control, what is it? Edit, redo control Y. Control Y. Darn, I did like how that looked before. Okay, just going to have to sample again. My mistake. Let's see. No. It is a little bit of a trial and error sort of thing, trying to get lucky as you're sampling your surface to find something that looks pretty good. You know what? I'm happy with that. That looks pretty nice. that looks okay. The only thing we're going to want to do here is add a little bit of a, we're going to multiply the knots on top of each other, because you notice that knots in a wood surface tend to be a lot darker than the surface underneath, so we just want to darken these up just a little bit. I'm going to add a blend, pop that in our background. We're going to pop these in our foreground, but I'm going to invert them. Invert grayscale. Whoops, it tried to plug it in over there. Invert grayscale. So now that the knots are actually dark and the background is white, so we can actually use our multiply to darken the knots. Let's plug that into our blend. And oops, we have an error here. We have color and grayscale input trying to go in the same place. Let's just add a gradient map here and tap D to collapse it. Set it to multiply. And now you can see that it's really darkened up the colors there, which is what we were hoping for. That's a little bit strong, so let's go ahead and pull the opacity back 0.42, maybe? 42? There we go, I think that's looking pretty good. Alright, now the last step is to expose our roughness parameters and start working on that. Now, a quick and easy starting point technique for starting your roughness maps is that usually the roughness, it works really well if you take the inverse of your height information as like the basis of it. So if I take this, invert it, you'll see now that the low areas are bright and the high areas are dark. And this is just because like the high areas are gonna, or the low areas are gonna be where the ambient occlusion is, where the grunge is gonna build up. You usually get sort of less light getting out of there, it's less shiny down there. It's good. It's a good starting point. So I'm gonna plug that into our roughness as just the first step. Now the problem is that the light is sort of glimmering in line with the wood grain, just a little bit too much. So we want to add some grunge in there to sort of break up the light just that little bit more. So that looks, that's a pretty good grunge map. Looks kind of like wood grain with some stains and some randomness in there. That's pretty good. So go ahead, plug that to our background, plug that to our foreground. Can move these up a bit to separate them off and the roughness separated off from our normal maps. Make sure everything's separate. I'm actually gonna, in fact, going to grab these and in fact frame them. I know we didn't do much with our base color, but you know, you want to make sure that you have everything organized. Base color, frame this as our roughness. Grunge map there. Set it to like screen. Play with the intensity, maybe 0.45 for the intensity. Let's see, roughness. I think I'm gonna need to rotate that by 90 degrees because it's sort of going against the grain there and it looks just that little bit strange. At least in my eyes. That's pretty good. And then I'm going to take this and, same as I always do for everything, it seems, use a histogram scan to control our inputs. And I can bring that way up to like 0.62. You get a really, really rough surface overall. Maybe 0.55. Get a fairly rough surface with little glimmers of light. I think that's looking pretty good. And now we can go back and we can start exposing parameters. So I can go down to, say, our mask input, expose this as new knots amount. Scroll up, make sure that we're using the same parameter for both. So you can expose that as knots amount. You can expose the tiling here as your knots. Circles? I don't know how you would call that. The concentric circles in the in the knots. The rings in the knots, that would have been the word to use. Oh well, I've already hit enter there. Whoopsies. And you can expose different parameters. I could add a hue, saturation, lightness, a HSL node in here. You could expose your saturation and lightness controls. I could expose my roughness over here as roughness. And then if I go click on our material, go to preview mode. Oops, it seems to have like changed the name here. Yeah, they did. They didn't keep my name. They tried to automatically label it. That's weird. There we go. And so now if you go in here, you can go ahead, like increase the number of knots on the surface. You can decrease the number of rings that each knot has. You can make the surface really, really shiny, like it just rained or something along those lines. Whatever you want to do, you now have these exposed parameters to do whatever you want with your surface. Really, really cool. So last thing I'm going to do here, I think I'm just going to play around with our ambient occlusion just a little bit, make it a little bit more prominent. There we go. That's looking pretty good, I think. All right, cool. Well, there you have it, guys. Generic wood surface with randomly placed knots, exposed controls for them, including things like the rings and the knots and warping of the wood grain, things along those lines. I definitely think there's a few interesting techniques here, like how to use the gradient dynamic node to create concentric rings, and how to do procedural warping, things along those lines. So I hope you guys learned a few useful techniques and tricks here, and have a great day, everybody.